Great. Good afternoon, everyone. It actually really warmed my heart to hear him say, we have a beautiful vision, because I'm here to talk to you about a really ugly concept. Killing. How many people in the room are in favor of killing? Nobody, right? But it's been one of the central endeavors of human history. Right, from the Stone Age to the Nuclear Age, we have spent more time figuring out how to kill each other than just about anything else. In fact, we track the eras of our history on the weapons. Right? We call it the Nuclear Age, the Stone Age. So I want to invite you all to listen with an open mind for the next 20 minutes, because I want to challenge the way you think about this. So I get to meet a person who's in favor of killing, but it happens, and it happens a lot. So that begs the question, why? Why do we kill? In specific, I want to focus in on an area that's getting a lot of attention right now, and rightfully so, police shootings. So let's ask the question, when do police shoot to kill? They don't. Actually, it's illegal for a police officer to shoot for the purpose of killing. They are trained, and their legal obligation is they can only shoot to stop a threat. This is a really important concept, because any time that a police officer takes a life, you're likely to hear, this is the central theme of what's described. I had no choice. I had to stop a threat, and I had no choice but to kill them. So to me, killing is a technology problem. Killing is actually a byproduct of the lawful objective of what somebody's doing. It's an unintended consequence. So how do you start to separate the intended from the unintended? Now, for many people, the natural reaction is, you know, we think of this as a government problem, as a regulatory problem. We need to pass a new law to deal with this. Unfortunately, if you're waiting for the government to solve this problem, it is going to be a long time. Because we passed the first major gun control act in 1968 when there were 23,000 gun fatalities a year, and now we're over 35,000. So, there's a huge debate on gun control. Have we not gone far enough? Can it never work? I don't have the answer to that question, but I can tell you what we're doing isn't fixing the problem from a public policy perspective. Now, I got interested in this space. I was in graduate school in the early 1990s, living in Belgium, and two of my friends were shot and killed back in Scottsdale, Arizona, in the parking lot of a golf resort. So Corey and Todd were driving down Scottsdale Road on a Friday night, and they cut off the wrong guy, and the situation spun out of control, tempers flared, and they both shot and killed by a guy who actually was a business consultant with a gun in the glove box and a bad temper. And one thing that struck me about this is I started to think about and read about the magnitude of this problem. Like many of us, I turned to science fiction, wait a minute. Why is the state of the art in 1993 shooting people with lead balls? You'd think we would have come further, right? Captain Kirk never whips out a Glock and blows a hole in a Klingon. That would look bizarre. Just like today, it would look bizarre if you walked around with a sword on your hip, right? Technology has the opportunity to change. There was a day when people couldn't imagine not having a sword for self-protection, and yet the world moves on. So I did a survey at the time, and I said, okay, what are the closest things that we have to the Star Trek phaser? What can somebody use besides a bullet? And I was pretty astounded to see not a lot of technology. In fact, if you look on a police officer's belt, you're going to see a gun, and then these are their other options. You've got a baton, basically the club we've been using since the caveman days. You can do various sorts of fighting and hitting people. Or one of the newest innovations are these chemical sprays, chemical irritants. They create a very painful sensation, basically spraying an acidic solution in somebody's face. Actually, Berkeley did some interesting studies on this. What they found was these pepper sprays, these chemical irritants, they actually work well on passive people. But that's not what we need to deal with when we're dealing with a violent situation. In fact, they found that if you take a violent person who's angry and mad, like in a domestic violence situation, now insert pain, it goes the other direction. And so this is the state of the art. Just as it was 200, 300 years ago, we've been killing each other with hot balls of lead. Revolutionary War and well before. Now, over that same time period, it's no shock, Every other industry has changed dramatically. But think about what's happening in medicine or transportation. There was a day when people couldn't imagine giving up their horse, right? And now we're flying on intercontinental jets and soon we'll be going to space. And yet, the industry around self-protection still relies on this outdated technology. So we have this very simple scale of the tools available today. You can cause pain on someone. If that doesn't stop them, you injure them with a baton or something. And if that doesn't work, you inflict death. So as I look at this, I thought, well, these are all really crude technologies. What's another engineering approach? Is there another way to come at this problem? And my undergraduate degree was in neurobiology. I was very interested. I wanted to build robotic limbs like Luke Skywalker had. I was very interested in the human-machine interface. And so I'd studied neurobiology. And I very quickly came to think, well, wouldn't it be beautiful, in a relative sense, or at least less ugly, if we could create a system that could stop a threat through the nervous system rather than through injury or death? Now, there's two ways you can do this, because the nervous system, of course, is an electrochemical system. You could start with chemistry, right? We use tranquilizer darts on animals. We use anesthetics in surgery. In fact, there's a history, a very negative history, of neurochemicals being used in warfare. These have some real challenges around them. Tranquilizer darts, for example, I've frequently heard or read editorials, people saying, why don't we use tranquilizer darts? Well, it's really hard to get the dosing right. Right? An anesthesiologist is constantly monitoring the patient. They know their body type, their body mass. They're monitoring all the dosing. Administering these chemicals is very hard to do. Those tranquilizer darts take about 3 to 5 minutes to act, and they have about a 20% fatality rate. So I think chemical approaches have a real challenge. However, electrical approaches can be really pretty interesting. So also at Berkeley, a researcher named Dalziel did a lot of work right after, I think it was in the 1940s, and he did this with his students, and his students hold on to electrodes. They're like, all right, let's see how electricity impacts the body. Can't really do this sort of testing very well anymore. And he started tuning up the electricity, and here's what he found. At low levels, at about 1 milliamp, you have the threshold of sensation. So first it starts to tingle, then you turn it up, and you get to pain. And then you get to this area where something interesting happens. You hit the let-go threshold. And he called it the let-go threshold because people could no longer let go. They were paralyzed. Their hands could no longer let go. There was a comment in one of the earlier talks about people have heard about this with electric fences and other things. Well, if we think about incapacitation, what if we could design a system that could take a person to the let-go threshold, lock up their body, but have a reversible effect? Well, what the research showed was before you get, you obviously want to have a large safety margin. Well, electricity has this wonderful property for this perspective that it has a more than 10 to 1, it's an order of magnitude safety margin. So in thinking about electricity as an approach to creating a new class of weapon, again, science fiction with all these energy weapons sort of got it right. Because you have a very high safety margin between the effective dose and the lethal dose. There's an immediacy to the effect. Because of the high safety margin, dosing is much easier to control, and you can have a very immediate and strong effect. In fact, we commercialized this technology, a device called a taser, which launches out two electrodes, and it attaches to a person. Obviously, we're showing illustratively here. We then apply electrical impulses above the let-go threshold to cause what looks like an involuntary seizure. Now, what this does to a person is pretty ugly. It is not a nice thing to do. I've done it 7 times personally, and it is unpleasant. However, the 99.99% of the time, people recover with no injury. The safety ratings on this technology is about 2 orders of magnitude better than anything else on the market. Now, just comparing pepper spray, this is the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Officer on the left was hit in the face with pepper spray. He's in pain, but he's still able to attack a target. That didn't stop the threat. Same officer on the right, applied with an electrical weapon. You can see the effect is strong and immediate. We've hit over, I think, 2 million police officers with this technology now. So we've got a ton of data on the effects. In fact, we're getting to the point where I'm now starting to talk openly about going after the bullet. I had to be very careful because we sell to police agencies, and police officers, their gun is their lifeline, and you've got to be very careful when you start talking about disrupting that. But we're now showing, in laboratory conditions, we can outperform a pistol. Now, not in the field yet, but just to demonstrate this, this is the commander of the Czech national SWAT team. We gave him a gun and said, try and pull the trigger. Obviously, it was unloaded. A trained professional could not move his finger 1 inch to get down and operate the trigger. That's an immediate effect. Now, I don't want to set expectations too high. I said in laboratory conditions. Right now, these devices only have one or two shots, limited range. You've got to get two electrodes on the target and get it through clothing. So there are reliability things that prevent this from yet being a suitable substitute for firearms. But that's where we're headed. So over the past 20 years since we introduced this, these devices have been used in 180,000 situations where police officers were legally justified to use lethal force. So we have 180,000 cases, excuse me, where officers now had a choice. But I would guess what you've heard about these technologies wasn't about the lives saved. Unfortunately, as we've talked about throughout this conference, right, the media focuses our reptilian brains on negative news. And so far more likely, you've seen things like this, because there are still cases where people are hurt or even killed when these technologies are used, although it's dramatically less than it is with conventional technologies. So, one of the things I want to accomplish today is I want to talk to the community here of the world's leading technologists, because San Francisco is one of only two major cities in North America that is not using this technology. And for the past 10 years, the chief of police has been, various chiefs have tried to introduce it, and it's been blocked every time. And there's a lot of emotion on this topic. And as a result, the police deployed bigger batons. They're now carrying 3-foot instead of 2-foot batons. And over the past 17 years, they've shot and killed 40 people, many of which were candidates that I think could have been saved. So, this to me is a perplexing question. What's going on? Why is the technology capital of the world so resistant to a technology with some pretty clear benefits? I grew up here and I went to high school in Palo Alto. So I think I understand the vibe, and I think the challenge is this is such a hopeful place. There's so much positive energy here. This is a place where people think they can change the world, and they do, time and time again. However, the problem I'm talking about is an ugly problem. And people typically don't want to work on ugly problems. Right? You almost feel like you're becoming part of the problem. But I can tell you, seeing how our company and our products are portrayed in the media, it's not always pleasant. You've got to have pretty thick skin. So I think while people here are very hopeful, and there's a lot of movement around things like police reform, and you've got one of the most intensive police oversight functions in San Francisco City over police of anywhere in the world. But unfortunately, oversight and hope alone is not strategy. Right? I've talked about all of the effort and pain and suffering that's gone into the gun control issue, and yet we still have, even with the events, I don't even have to name them, of these mass shootings, et cetera, the regulatory approach isn't working so far. Now, I don't think we should stop those things. We need to continue to hope, and we need to continue to push mankind to get better, but our strategy cannot be that we're just going to change the nature of man. We've been fighting for thousands of years. We need to accept that that's a fact of life, and until it changes, we also need to have some strategy approaches. And that's one of the things I love about the Singularity community, that Singularity is doing a great job of focusing the tech community that, hey, there's big problems to be solved, right? We can't just work on the next social application. We've got to work on these big problems facing the world, and security is one of them. And I would tell you, it can be one of the hardest. Because, for example, when you're working on solving hunger, that is a very worthwhile thing. It's not particularly controversial. When you start getting engaged here and inserting technology into these crisis situations, it becomes very controversial. And as a result, I think we've seen a little bit of this, where this is an ugly area, and sometimes it's easier to just look the other way and let somebody else deal with it. In fact, Facebook and Google, two companies I greatly admire, passed a policy where they said, you know what, we're not going to be part of the problem. We don't want to support violence. They're not allowing any advertising of any weapons on their platforms. And I get the intention. It is well-intentioned. They don't want to make the problem worse. However, I would propose that That's not going to stop the gun industry, and it's not going to stop the trade of arms. There's hundreds of millions of firearms in the country. But what it will do is it impedes the pace of change. Because how do you cause change now? It happens online. That's how you reach out, how you educate people. So disruptors that try to come in, frankly, like us, and trying to say, hey, let's come at this from a different angle, rather than causing pain or death. Can we find a new way? It actually greatly slows us down because some of the most influential organizations in the world are very intentionally looking the other way. So I think there's a challenge when we look at new things, we can look at them in a vacuum and say, oh, this is sort of creepy, right? Hitting people with electricity. But you have to compare it to the now. What is the state of affairs we're in now? So now let me step out from police work. I want to run to sort of the crazy edge of what's possible. Let's talk about war. Let's talk about robots in war. So I think the first thing people immediately jump to is this idea of the Terminator, right? We don't want machines out there killing people. And by the way, I agree with that 100%. However, this is one of those cases where we start thinking about how we use robots and drones and autonomous systems. I don't think the easy answer of no, we shouldn't use them is the right answer. What if we thought of what's happening in war or in war-torn areas? One thing about autonomous systems is they don't have a rationale that says, I had to kill to protect myself. It gives us the ability to start thinking about how do we put time and space between people so that things don't flare up where lethal force becomes justified. I had some really interesting talks with some military leaders who initially were very skeptical on this idea. Wait a minute, non-lethals in warfare? So, well, wait a minute, think about Mosul or Raqqa or these cities that we're dealing with where you've got combatants interspersed with the public. What's the state of affairs now? Well, now we try to, the tools we use are 2,000-pound bombs dropped on neighborhoods. We try to rely on good intelligence to make sure we only kill the bad guys, but it doesn't always work out. And in fact, strategically, even killing the bad guys is not productive. We're creating martyrs that become recruiting tools. When you kill innocents, you actually make the problem worse. So we're getting ready to spend $1 trillion upgrading our nuclear defense system. $1 trillion. And I can tell you, I'm close to this industry, the amount that is being spent looking at disruptive ways to accomplish missions without killing rounds to zero by comparison. And I think given the types of conflict in the world today, that's a capability we should at least be talking about. And we need the technology leaders of the world to be talking about and engaging in it too. We can't just step away and ignore it. War, violence, it's a fact of life. We should continue to try to contain it. We should also try to make it less bad. And so with that, I think there's an opportunity for us to take this awful concept of killing and tease it apart and make it obsolete. And I invite all of you to engage in some way. I'd be happy to take questions. I'm past my time now, so I'll be around during the breaks. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on how we might move this concept forward of moving past the species that is just getting better and better at killing each other. Thank you.